Well, hello everybody. Good morning. Welcome to Ashley Valley Calvary Chapel. In case you couldn't tell, I am not Phil. Phil is sick today, so I'm the pinch hitter. I'd like to welcome anybody that's a guest here today. We are glad to have you. If you get an opportunity before you leave today, if you're visiting with us, we have some visitor cards on the back donation box back there by the door as you walk in there. If you could fill one of those out, if you want a member of our leadership team to meet with you, we will be more than happy to do that. We're going to go ahead and open up with prayer, and then we're going to do a couple of announcements, and then I shall turn it over to these fine young gentlemen up here to lead us in worship. Dear Lord Father, we just love you. We praise you and we give you the glory for this beautiful day that you created for us. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege and the honor that we have to be able to enter into your house today and just to praise you, sing songs of praise and to study your word and to just be lifted higher, Lord. Every moment that we get to spend with you is never a wasted moment, Lord, and help us to always remember that, to always make time in our crazy busy lives that I know we all have, Lord, to take time to set aside to spend with you, which is what we're doing here today, Lord. So we just give this time to you. We give this place to you, Lord. This entire service from start to finish, whether it's here in the adult service, Lord, or in the CKC area, the middle school, junior high room, or in the fourth and fifth grade classroom, Lord. It's all about you. It's all about Jesus. And Father, I pray that all of the teachers here today, Lord, that they would be teaching your words, Lord, and that all the students, including us in here, Lord, today, would be open and receptive to the word that you have for us today out of your word, and that we wouldn't just hear the word, Lord, but as it says in James, we would become doers of it. Because just listening to it being preached is not enough. We need to apply it to our lives and to live it out, Lord, to become more like the people that you call us to be. So we just give this time to you. We praise you. We give you the glory. And it's in the name of Jesus that I pray these things. Amen. A couple of quick announcements before they get into worship. There is a golf tournament that is going to happen a week from today at 3 o'clock at the golf course over here in Vernal. It's for anybody at any level, so you don't have to be a PBA golf player to do it. They're only doing 9 holes as part of the tournament. If you want to do more, you can. There will also be good barbecue at the restaurant at the golf course. And Bob is asking that you would sign up. This thing sticks out. So, beat myself with it now. So, it's for golf tournament next Sunday, 3 p.m. for all levels. So, you don't have to be a pro. It's 9 holes, and there will be also good barbecue at the golf course restaurant. Bob wants you to sign up. He has a paper out there in the foyer to sign up with. And also, VBS is coming up next month. It's going to be on June 9th through the 22nd. 19th through the 22nd. I should just let Garrett do the announcements. Apparently, I'm not doing so well. From 6 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. on those days. And you'll notice that is only 4 days. It's not the typical 5 that we usually do. And there's a volunteer sign-up sheet out in the foyer as well for that. There are a few spots where we still need some volunteers. So if you believe that you have time and the ability to volunteer, whether it's from helping to decorate the church, because that takes a lot of work, takes about a week leading up to VBS to decorate the church, to signing in kids as they come in or whatever, just look at the sign-up sheet out there and where you see a blank spot. We would be more than happy for you to sign your name. Anything else? I think that's it.
Have at it.
All right. Well, you can stand or remain seated. whatever you want to do, but we just want to worship the Lord and focus on Him right now. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. Just help us to remember, Lord, that your grace is sufficient. And in your weakness, in our weakness, Lord, you are made strong.
heavens proclaiming you day after day, and I know in my heart that there must be a way to sing a greater song, a greater song to you on the earth, to sing a greater song, a greater song to you on the earth. Who could imagine a symphony grand enough to tell of your glory? Our highest praise but a feeble breath, a whisper of your thunderous word. I see the heavens proclaiming you day after day, and I know to sing a heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are
Father, just be with us during this devotional time now. Help Rodney to devote himself to you, Lord, and to share your word. Just anoint him now, Lord.
know we all feel it, but what a blessing it is to have these guys on our worship team. Yeah. What a privilege it is to be here today in God's house with God's people on Memorial Day, and in honor of Memorial Day and the men that women armed forces that have paid the ultimate price, today's devotion is on the character of a good soldier. In 1 Timothy 6:12, Paul calls on believers to fight the good fight, the fight of faith. Like first century Christians, believers today are in a three-front war against the flesh, the world system, and Satan, our enemy. The military metaphor is a good reminder that believers must prepare for daily spiritual battle. A good soldier puts on the armor of God daily. A good soldier is strong in Christ. Paul knew that the Lord stood by his side and strengthened him during trials. The Holy Spirit provides the courage and power to obey God's commands so we can rely upon his might to carry us to victory against any enemy. Always remember, greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. A good soldier shares knowledge. The church possesses not only the good news about salvation, it has all the riches of God's word. And I want to just focus on all. It's complete. Okay? Many people have listened to biblical teaching and experienced the Lord's interceding in their lives. To keep those lessons to oneself can leave unbelievers in harm's way and deprive fellow Christians of necessary wisdom and edification. So we're called to share his word, to share his love, and share your testimony with others. To be a good soldier, also, one suffers willingly. Hardship is part of combat and therefore part of the Christian experience. Believers will endure adversity and be asked to make sacrifices. It is little wonder then Paul reminds Timothy to stand strong in the Lord and to uphold others. A wise commanding officer gives his troops a war cry that encourages their hearts and emboldens their steps. Paul had one. Remember Jesus. Focus on Jesus. Keep in mind that you serve an all-powerful God. He stands beside you. He takes part in your suffering. And he holds you securely through the most formidable battles. God will never leave you nor forsake you. As we remember our American soldiers this Memorial Day, specifically those who stood tall and those who paid the ultimate price to stand up for our American way of life. Remember, you too are called to be spiritual soldiers of Jesus Christ and to fight the good fight, to share the message of God's word with the lost world, and to serve others, remembering the ultimate victory we all share in Jesus Christ. We are all in the Lord's army. Let's pray. Dear Lord, you are our rock. You are our fortress. You are our strong deliverer. In you alone we trust. We thank you for the great lengths that you have gone to draw us near to you. Thank you that is nothing to do with what we do, but everything to do what you have already done. Your provision through Christ Jesus on the cross. Help us to empty ourselves and to run to you, that in our weakness you are made strong. Lord, we pray for our nation, for mercy, that we may turn back to you as a people, for our leadership, pray for wisdom and hearts that will follow your will and lead according to your word. Lord, we pray for our soldiers, past, present, and future, and give thanks for their sacrifices and service that they have shown our nation. We pray for them and their families. Pray for those who are serving, who have served. Pray for the peace, continued provision, and protection. Let them know how much we all appreciate their selfless sacrifice to our country and to our people. We pray for our brothers and sisters around the world, Lord, the persecuted church. Sustain them, meet their daily needs, and help them stand strong for the cause of Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. Protect them from the influences of the enemy, and help them stand strong in the ultimate victory we all share in Jesus. We pray for Israel, Lord. We pray for protection. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem, as your word tells us to do. We pray for its leaders, for wisdom and understanding, but ultimately for their salvation and the day they will see and understand Jesus as the true Messiah. We pray for our building project, continued provision, your will and timing over all aspects of this project, and that you will make yourself known, glorified, and you would enlarge the body of believers right here in Vernal through this project. Lord, we pray for the sick, pray for our pastor, pray for the unspoken needs of people right here and now in our church family. Meet those needs and those people right where they're at, and let them know how much you love and the purposes you have for each and every one of them. We pray for the message today. We pray your people be affirmed and lifted up by it. May Rob's words be your words. And lastly, we want to celebrate, we want to lift up, again, our graduates and their families, and as they go forward and start new chapters in their lives, we pray the Christian foundations they grow upon, they have grown up upon, will serve them well, that your holy word would be their guide in their life, and that Jesus would prepare the way for them, and that they would remain sensitive to the leadership of the Holy Spirit in their lives and in all that they do. Surround them by other like-minded believers and let them know how much you love them. Father God, in all things, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we pray these all in the matchless and mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Father God, we take this time, Lord, to remember all the men and women who were called into the service, Lord, but never returned home. We thank you, Lord, that there were and still are men and women in this nation today that willingly volunteer to stand in harm's way for our sakes, for our liberties, to protect us, Lord, from those who would mean to do us harm. We thank you, Lord, that these are men and women of honor and virtue and integrity. Lord, that they take the oath that they swear on the day they're indoctrinated in, Lord, seriously, and completely understand that oath that they swear may mean that they will never see their families again, and yet they still willingly answer that call. Lord, I want to lift up the family members of all those in here today, Lord, who may have lost a loved one, whether recently or in the distant past. Lord, the pain never goes away, so I pray your peace for them. For those of us that have friends, acquaintances that we knew that have paid that ultimate price, Lord, I pray for peace over all of us as well. It is a hard life, both as the service member, Lord, and as a family member of them. But thank you, Lord, that there are those that still answer that call. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Somebody get the light back there. For all the fourth and fifth graders and middle school and junior high, you can head back to your classes. I don't think there's nearly as many today as there normally is. Memorial Day. A lot of people, I think, in our country today have forgotten exactly what it's all about. They kind of lump it into that general overall Veterans Day type thing. They just think we hold it twice a year. Memorial Day is actually a day to remember all of those that did go to war, did go into battle, and didn't come back home. Veterans Day is to celebrate those of us who answered the call and were lucky enough to make it back home. So, I won't ask if you were a veteran to stand up, but I will ask if you're someone who has a loved one that did go off and never come back, or if you have a friend or an acquaintance that lost their lives overseas, raise your hand. A few of you. That's what today is about. Well, technically tomorrow, but this whole weekend. Remember them. For those of you that haven't lost somebody, remember those that have. It's a hard time. I don't care if somebody was lost back in World War II, Vietnam, Korea, or in this war we find ourselves in now. The pain doesn't go away. It might dwindle down over time, but they need your prayers as much now as they did back when it happened. Today's message is going to be slightly tied into Memorial Day. Turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 26. We're going to read verses 6 through 13. And the message that the title of the message I'm going to be sharing today is called "What Will I Be Remembered By?" Of course, the obvious connotation is for veterans that have lost their lives. How do we remember them? We remember them through their sacrifice on Memorial Day. But it also has a personal connotation for each of us in here, as you'll see here in a minute. Meanwhile, Jesus was in Bethany at the home of Simon, a man who had previously had leprosy. While he was eating, a woman came in with a beautiful alabaster jar of expensive perfume and poured it over his head. The disciples were indignant when they saw this. "What a waste," they said. "It could have been sold for a high price and the money given to the poor." But Jesus, aware of this, replied, "Why criticize this woman for doing such a good thing for me? You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. She has poured this perfume on me to prepare my body for burial. I tell you the truth, that wherever the good news is preached throughout the world, this woman's deed will be remembered and discussed." If you read the same account of this in the Gospel of John, he also adds to it the fact that she didn't just pour the oil out over his head, but also his feet as well. And then she used her hair to wipe the perfume around on his feet. So she literally used the entire bottle. It wasn't just a couple of drops. If you notice, sometimes it's hard to see, but I'm wearing a poppy. For those of you that know about Memorial Day, its history, poppies started being a symbol of what the Europeans call Remembrance Day, and for us in America, Memorial Day, back after, well, during World War II, or actually World War I, back in 1915. And it comes from a poem that was written in 1915 called "In Flanders Field." I'm not going to read that poem to you because it's fairly lengthy. But I'm going to read to you a snippet that an American teacher got from that poem. Her name was Moena Michael. And when she read the poem about Flanders Field, she came up with the idea of using the poppy as a symbol. It was actually her that came up with the idea of it. She read these words, wrote these words to describe the feelings she got from reading "In Flanders Field." It says, "We cherish too the poppy red that grows on the fields where valor led. It seems to signal the skies that the blood of heroes never dies." In Flanders Field, what it discusses is that in these great big European battlefields where all these soldiers were being killed day after day after day, their blood poured into the ground, that in those areas where all these soldiers died, a poppy would grow up. Red flowers growing up out of the earth, right where all these people, these men and women, died. And so that is why now it becomes a symbol of Memorial Day, or if you're European, Remembrance Day. Remembering these people's sacrifices is what Memorial Day is all about. We pay tribute, we pay respect, we pay honor to all these men and women who can never come home. They gave up their lives so that we could live the freedoms out that we have today. Freedom is never free. We need to remember that. Just because you've never fought for it, it doesn't make it free. Somewhere, someone, somehow paid a price for the freedoms that we enjoy here in America. And we have been so very blessed in this country that with the exception of a terrorist attack in 9/11 and the attack on Pearl Harbor at what it was the beginning of World War II for America, this country has never seen war since the Civil War. So sometimes it's hard for us to really remember that somewhere, someone did pay the price for us to be safe. And it's because of these men and women fighting these battles over on these foreign shores that we have been spared the brunt of seeing a real war up close and personal here in our land. But a price was paid, and that price was innocent blood. The blood of these men and women paid the price for our civil freedoms, protecting our Constitution and our laws and our way of life. In the same way, we also need to remember that there was another person way back 2,000 years ago whose blood also paid a price for a freedom that if you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you have. Innocent blood was spilt by our Creator, our Lord, and who now is our Savior. Not for our civil freedoms, not to protect our Constitution, but to protect our very salvation. Much higher price. And a much greater gift. I'm not going to belittle the death of the men and women that protect our constitutional law that we have here in America. But that's a temporary, fleeting thing. One day that Constitution's going to be gone. Maybe sooner than later. I don't know. But the price that Jesus paid gives us something that will last forever. Our salvation. Our spirit. Our soul that will live forever in heaven when God calls us home. Romans 5 verses 6 and 8 tells us that when we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Now most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who is especially good. But God showed His great love for us by sending Christ to die while we were yet still sinners. He died for us while we were still in open and active rebellion against Him. We set aside a day to remember the price paid by those who died for our civil freedoms. Memorial Day, that's what this day is all about. But how should we honor the price paid by our Lord and our Savior, our Creator God, who willingly stepped out of heaven to live among us, His creation, to ultimately die a sinner's death on a cross? How should we honor that sacrifice? First, we need to acknowledge that it was necessary that He did it. If you think that you have no reason to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then you're not accepting that what He did had a purpose. So first, you need to accept that He came here for a reason. He didn't just give up heaven for nothing. He didn't just decide one day He wanted to walk among His creation. He came here on a mission, and that mission was to save His creation from the wages of their sin. When we acknowledge that we needed what He did for us, the next logical step is to accept Him as our Lord and Savior. Make what He did have a purpose in your life. Then we need to live a life, our lives, in a way that honors Him. We honor those men and women that died on those battlefields by how we remember them, by how we treat them, by how we treat their graves, by how we minister to their families. We honor Jesus by how we live our lives according to His word, according to the way He lived it when He was here all those years ago walking this earth. Our desire should be that from the point of our salvation forward, people don't see us anymore as the same person that we always were before that salvation happened. But then they start to see more and more and more of Jesus in us, reflected in our actions, in our attitudes, in our words, in our lifestyle, and less and less and less of that person that we used to be, that was led by a sin nature. We will never reach a point of perfection. That's not what we're aiming for. But our goal should always be that every day we're growing more and more into the likeness of Jesus Christ. And that should be what people see. Mary, the woman in the story we were reading in Matthew chapter 26, showed us exactly this kind of life. Mary was the sister of Martha and the sister of another man named Lazarus. She's only mentioned in the scriptures three times. The first is found in Luke chapter 10, verse 38 through 42. In those verses, we see her sitting at the feet of Jesus. Jesus had come over to visit Mary, Martha, and Lazarus' house. Martha was off busy, getting food ready, getting the house all squared away, kind of mad at Mary that she was just sitting at Jesus' feet, not helping. But Mary knew the right place to be. Jesus had come there to hang out with them and to teach, as he always did. He was a teacher. He was a rabbi. And Mary says, if my Savior is in my house right now, about to teach, where else would I be? I'm going to sit at his feet and listen to every word that comes out of his mouth. That's the first time we see her. The second time we see her is in John chapter 11, verses 28 through 32. Here we find Mary in anguish because her brother Lazarus had gotten sick and had died. A few days before, they had sent a message to Jesus telling him, look, Jesus, your friend Lazarus is on his deathbed. Hurry up and come here because we know you can heal him if you would just come now. But Jesus didn't just come now. He chose to wait a couple of days before he left to go back to visit Lazarus. There was a purpose for that. But Mary and Martha didn't understand it. So when Jesus finally got there, Mary ran, fell at his feet in anguish, tears pouring out of her eyes, and said, Jesus, if you had only been here. So she sat at his feet when he taught. She fell at his feet when she was broken. And then the third time we see her is in the verses we read. After Jesus had raised her brother Lazarus back from the dead, this account that we read in Matthew chapter 26 was just a couple of days later. She's falling at his feet again, anointing him and praising him and thanking him for the healing miracle that he gave to her brother Lazarus. Her faith had been tested. She wondered why Jesus waited, but then he showed himself faithful. He showed himself beyond any shadow of any doubt in her mind that he was truly the Messiah. And she falls down at his feet and anoints him. So she's a pretty special lady. Some people, Bible teachers, say that there's two disciples that you can definitively pinpoint that truly got the message that Jesus was trying to teach in his last week on earth, that he had come, in fact, not to overthrow the Roman government, but to die a sinner's death on the cross. Those two people were Judas and Mary. Judas shows us that he got what the message was because he left and betrayed Jesus and sold him out to his enemies for 30 pieces of silver. He got the point that Jesus wasn't hanging around to take the Romans out. The other person that got it was Mary. And how do you know that she got that message? Because of what she did in these verses. This was a week before Jesus was going to die. It wasn't like he was on the cross and she's like, oh, I finally get it. He came here to die. This was a week before he was about to die. And what is she doing? She's anointing his body for his death. How did Mary pick up on what so many of the other disciples missed? It's because where you find her at every single time the scriptures talk about her. Where is she? She's at his feet. She's listening to him. Not just listening to him, she's enraptured by him. That's her testimony. Anytime her Savior is anywhere nearby, she is going to be at his feet listening to him. It's been said that we write our own eulogy by the life that we live. Mary wrote hers by showing her complete and total faith in Jesus. She was found at his feet every opportunity she had, never missing an opportunity to be in his presence. And Jesus said that as a result of the faith that she showed, she would be remembered every time the good news was read for her actions. What message are you leaving by the life that you're living? Exactly what is it that people will remember you for when you're no longer with us? Those who die on the field of battle are remembered for heroism. They're remembered for courage. They're remembered for sacrifice. Mary's remembered for her lavish gift of the perfume she poured out over Jesus' head and his feet. What is your legacy? Let's use our scriptures that we read in Matthew chapter 26 to go through four possibilities of how we might be remembered after we leave this world. First, we can be remembered for a selfless approach. We read that Mary approached Jesus at this feast. She approached him, but how was that selfless? Well, it was selfless because in Jesus' day, it was forbidden for a woman to enter a feast that was made up of men that were not part of her immediate family. The disciples were her friends. They knew her, they were acquaintances, but these people were not her family. So the men ate in one place and the women ate in another place if they were not directly related. So for her to enter into that feast was scandalous. She could have been torn apart by these men for what she was about to do, enter into their presence for something other than delivering more food for them and then turning around and leaving. But Mary didn't let that hinder her, because her honor, or her focus that day, was to show honor and worship to her Savior. Her Savior was in that room. It didn't matter to her that so were a bunch of other guys. All she was focused on is, Jesus is here. That's where I need to be. I don't need to be sitting outside this door. I don't need to be cooking more food. My Jesus is in here. And by this point, somehow or another, whether it was the leading of the Holy Spirit or the teaching that Jesus was actually teaching her, by that point she had realized that he was about to die soon. And she wanted to honor him and honor that sacrifice she knew he was about to make the only way she knew how, the best way that she could possibly do it. And that was by going into that room in the middle of that feast, no matter who else was sitting there, and anointing his head and anointing his feet, preparing his body for burial. And I would go even further to say that she was okay that those other men were in there, because she wanted to make sure that every person that she knew that Jesus was her Savior, including those men. Because what does it tell us in Matthew chapter 10, verse 32? Matthew 10:32 tells us that everyone who acknowledges me publicly here on earth, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. She had a ready-made audience locked in that room that she could acknowledge her Lord and Savior before. And she was going to take advantage of that. But I guarantee you that even had those men not been in there, she was still going to anoint Jesus and prepare his body for the death that she knew was going to come. Now, it's sad today that selflessness is a dying trait. And it's really sad to admit that it's not just a dying trait for non-believers, but it's also a dying trait for believers as well. Being selfless is just not vogue anymore, especially in the American church. We're just as caught up in the what can I get, how much can I get, and how quickly can I get it attitude that we find everywhere else in our society. We'll give when we have an abundance of something, whether it's our time, whether it's our talent, whether it's our money. We give, but it's not to be selfless. More often than not, it's because, hey, I got this anyway, I may as well give it. But that's not the attitude and the action that the Bible says that we as Christians are to have. Mary gave something special to Jesus. She didn't give some weak, cheap, knockoff perfume to anoint his body with. She gave the most expensive perfume, most expensive balm that you could find in her day and time. She had a little alabaster jar, probably not bigger than those little doTERRA things we see all over the place anymore. But that little bottle of perfume called spikenard was valued at 3,000 denarii. The Bible tells us clearly in John that was worth a year's wages for an agricultural worker. In today's money, that's like $20,000. She didn't just anoint just the tip of his head and the tip of his feet. She poured the whole bottle out over him. It wasn't out of an abundance of something she had that she gave. It was everything she had that she gave. That is being selfless. That's being sacrificial. That's giving Jesus the best that she had, and not just some of it, but all of it. She came to him with complete abandon. She was totally selfless, and she was completely devoted to him. To live like she lived is to make Jesus your everything, and understand that he deserves nothing but your best and all that you have. Scriptures make it clear that we can only serve one master. In Matthew 6:24 it says, "No one can serve two masters, for you will hate one and you will love the other. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. You can substitute money for whatever it is that you have that you're holding on to as tight as you can, that you think is more important than anything, including Jesus. Time, money, toys, a house, a car. I don't care what it is, a job. All are great things. But if you're holding on to these things with such a tight grip, that should the Holy Spirit come to you one day and stir you and prompt you and say, look, that thing you're holding on to, I want you to give it up. I want you to use that to advance God's kingdom somehow, some way. Did Mary probably wrestle with using that bottle of perfume that cost $20,000? Maybe. She was human. She wasn't Jesus. She wasn't holy. She wasn't the Son of God. Human beings struggle. But all we see is the end result. That maybe even if she did struggle, she still chose to use that perfume to anoint Jesus. Do we have that same spirit in us? Are we as willing as she was to part with something that is so important, that could do so much good in some other way besides being used for God? She could have justified just as easily as the disciples did when she used it to sell it, take the money. She could have justified leaving it sitting on her shelf in case of an emergency. She could have justified getting the cash and using it to feed the poor. She probably could have fed hundreds, if not thousands, of poor, needy people in her community by selling that little bottle of perfume. And all those were excuses that were given by the disciples why she should not have done what she did with Jesus and anoint him with it. But she had her priorities in the right place. She says, this is Jesus. He's my Savior. He's my Lord. He deserves my best. And however she knew that he was about to die, and she was going to anoint his body with the best of what she had to show him just how much she loved him. And she did it. She didn't care about all those other excuses, those other reasons why what she had could have been spent better elsewhere. Another way we can be remembered is to be sacrificial. To sacrifice means to do without, to give up, forego, to let go, or maybe even surrender. Americans today are not too keen on that word surrender. We're not keen about letting go. We're not keen about giving up. We're not keen about going without. We're all about holding on, getting more. We don't like to surrender. But make no mistake, sacrifice is the sacred thread woven throughout the life of every true believer. Because I challenge anyone in here today to read through the New Testament and prove to me somehow, some way, that sacrifice is not the blueprint that the early church was built upon. Everywhere you read in the New Testament, when you read about the disciples and the apostles and all the members of the early church, from beginning all the way through Revelation, they were sacrificing time and time and time again to see that God's kingdom moved forward. They weren't about getting. The only thing they were about getting was more believers. They weren't about hanging on to stuff. Everybody that had money in the church gave it away so that the other people that didn't have money in the church had money in the church. They weren't about holding on. They weren't about hoarding. Let's take a cue again from Mary in our earlier scriptures. She came to dinner that night and she brought some oil to anoint Jesus. And in those days, it was expected that you anointed your guests when they came into your home. Now, by anointing your guests, that means you take a little dab of oil, touch their head, they're anointed. It's what the proper hostess would do. But Mary anointed Jesus and then some. Head to foot, at most expensive perfume. And it's that and some and then some that we as Christians today need to get. It's that principle that we need to start incorporating into our lives. And it's that principle, that truth that Jesus was teaching when he was teaching the Beatitudes. Remember a few weeks ago, Phil was showing us around the Sea of Galilee where Jesus probably taught the Beatitudes from? Well, in those Beatitudes, one of the things Jesus was teaching was the truth of and then some. One of the things that he taught in the Beatitudes was, if a soldier demands you carry his gear for a mile, I say, you carry it too. That's and then some. He expects you to do this. Okay, do that. That's what's expected of you. But then do even more. As Christians, there's certain things we're expected to do. We're expected to pray for people. We're expected to read God's Word. We're expected to worship. We're expected to come to church. Well, I say do all of that stuff and then some. Don't stop at what you think is the minimum expected of you, because that's not what Jesus taught. Jesus didn't say, give me at least something. Jesus said, give me everything. You're my servants. Give me everything you have. Pick up your cross and follow me. He didn't say, when you had time. He didn't say, you know, when you weren't busy. You know, when you didn't have something else to spend that money on, then give some to me. Mary got it because she was so passionate about her Savior, she couldn't do it any other way. And then some was just wired into her because of how much she loved her Jesus. She loved him so much, she couldn't help but to give him a little of what was expected and then some. She didn't just love him just a little bit. She loved him with everything she had. He was that important to her. So my question to you is this. What is your bottle of perfume? Metaphorically. What is that thing? I don't want you calling it out, but I want you to think about it. I don't want you to glance over this question. I want you to seriously think, what is that one thing in your life that you can look at and say, you know, if the Holy Spirit asked me to give this up, I don't know. Could I do that? Would I do that? If God, for some reason, asked me to part with this, could I do it? And whatever that is for you, because we all are wired differently. We all have that thing or those things that to us, they mean everything. They might not mean anything to anybody else in this world, but to us, they're special. Whether it's our time, when you're not working, the last place you want to be is in church, so I'll go every once in a while to make a guest appearance. But my time is special to me. I could be out fishing. I could be out hunting. I could be up on the mountain today camping, because we know it's Memorial Day weekend. That's when you start go camping. So whatever that is for you, picture it in your head and then ask yourself, if the Holy Spirit asked me today to give this up, or to give more of what I'm already giving, would I do it? Will you be remembered as someone who gives or someone who hoards? Sacrifice is never easy. If it was, it would be called something else. It's called sacrifice for a reason. When you say, I sacrifice my time, I sacrifice my paycheck, I sacrifice my house, I sacrifice my car, it's a sacrifice. When a person sacrifices their life, it's called a sacrifice because it's painful, it hurts. It hurts that person, it hurts the people that are important to that person. It's never easy, but I can promise you, in God's eyes, it will also never be forgotten. If you're sacrificing something for Him, it's not a wasted thing. It's not a wasted effort. Because I can promise you that the treasures that you will get in return for whatever it is that you sacrifice for Him will be far more valuable to you than anything on this earth that you could ever possibly give up. There is nothing that you could ever possibly have in this world that will ever equal what you will have when you get to heaven and you're face to face with your Lord and your Savior. His word says to store up your treasures in heaven, not on earth where moths and rust can corrupt. So if you're storing your treasures up here on earth, then you got it backwards. Now, that's not to say you're not allowed to have toys and you're not allowed to have nice things. If God blesses you with the ability to do that, then that's awesome. That's a bonus. But you better not hold on to those things that he's blessed you with so tightly that if a day comes when he asks you to part with it, you refuse. Because then that just became your idol that you're putting in place of him. And that's not a good place to be. I hope that when he asks you to sacrifice, to make a sacrifice, that you will. And I hope that will be your legacy. Even if nobody on earth ever sees you do it, even if you're never given a single accolade by a single person, your God in heaven will see your sacrifice. And believe me when I tell you, he will honor you for it. Another way we can be remembered isn't a good way. We can be remembered by our sinful attitudes. Back to our verse, the men are eating their meal that the women just prepared for them. They're sitting around the table talking, doing their thing. Mary enters the room with that extravagant bottle of perfume. She uses the whole bottle on Jesus. The men get indignant. They're furious. Of course, the chorus leader of those angry men was Judas. Judas was the treasurer of the group. His job in that ministry was to take in the money that's donated to Jesus' ministry and to hold on to it and apportion it out where it needed to go. When they were going to the cities to have the feast like the one they were having here, it was his job to use the money that the ministry had to buy the provisions. If they needed to rent out the room, if somebody wasn't willing to donate it, it was his job to secure the room. If they needed a donkey for Jesus to ride in, it was his job to go pay for somebody and rent their donkey for Jesus to ride into town. He was the treasurer. So, of course, he would be the one to think, well, that could have been sold for $20,000, and think of how many people we could have fed with that. All these poor people that we see as we're going from town to town, those 5,000 people that we had to try to feed on the mountainside over there when Jesus was doing the Beatitudes, how much easier would that have been if we had had $20,000 to feed them with? It sounded righteous. It sounded like sound, reasonable thinking. Only we know in John that Judas wasn't exactly the best person to pick to be your treasurer. Because Judas liked to reach into the pot and pull some out. 2 for you, 10 for me. 10 for you, 100 for me. He wasn't thinking about the poor and the needy. He certainly wasn't thinking about the ministry opportunities. He was thinking about how much of that money would have worked for him. But the other disciples jumped onto the bandwagon when he started complaining too. And they were all saying the same thing he was. You wasted that whole bottle of perfume. So why were they all getting honor? If Judas was doing it through improper motives, why were the rest of the disciples joining in on the attack as well? It's because the people you surround yourself with influence you. Sometimes in good ways, sometimes in bad ways. Judas was an influence. Everything I see about him leads me to believe that he was probably one of those strong personality types. The type of person that people gravitate to and want to be like. He was a disciple. The disciples were important men. He was one of them, so he was an important man. and he was trusted with the money. So Jesus must have thought he was pretty important too. So they imitated him. It was a financial situation he was pointing out. He was the treasurer. He must have been right. So let's go along with Judas. Proverbs 22, verses 24 through 25 tells us this. Don't befriend angry people or associate with hot-tempered people, or you will learn to be like them and endanger your soul. You will become like the people you surround yourself with. That's what that's saying. So it's saying, be careful who you choose to be your friends. Be careful who you choose to be your circle of influence. Because if you choose the wrong people, you're going to act like the wrong people. And that's what happened to the disciples. They had Jesus. They could have imitated him. Mary was in that room too. They could have imitated her. They could have praised her and said, that was a great thing to do, Mary. You just anointed Jesus. He's our Savior. That was awesome. And Jesus was sitting back and he was letting her. He wasn't stopping her. So they could have taken the cue from him and said, well, this must be a good thing to do. But the one person in the room that had a problem with it, they all jumped on his bandwagon. I've heard it over and over and over again that I hang around with these guys from youth and from adults. I hang around with these guys, but you know, I'm there to be the witness. Yeah, I know they're a little rough around the edges. They're not always the best people, but they got to have a Christian there. I got to be the light. And that is the truth. We're called to go to the dark places and be the light. But how was Jesus able to pull off being the light every time he went to a dark place? He was able to do that because he spent like 90% of his life in prayer, talking to his Father. He was constantly in God's Word. Until we do that as well, then we need to stay away from people that could be a negative influence upon us. We can't be all the time hanging around people that we know are going to drag us down, because I promise you they will. Proverbs 22 wouldn't be included in the Bible if that wasn't a problem that we could potentially have. Never forget that our attitudes reflect the company that we keep. The people we surround ourselves with will influence us more often than we like to admit. Judas had a negative influence on the disciples. It was obvious by the way he reacted and then how they followed suit. Who do you surround yourself with? It's another one of those things you need to think about for yourself. Who do you surround yourself with? Are they the right people? Are they your positive influence or are they your negative influence? You want it to be like the cartoons? Are they the devil or the angel sitting on the shoulder? Lastly, we can be remembered for having a servant's attitude. Men and women of the military are called service members. Why? It's because they volunteer to give their lives in service for their country. It's a service. They certainly don't get paid enough for what they do. I can attest to that. Guess what? We're called to be servants as well. Jesus was Yahweh. He was the Son of God. He was the creator of everything we see. Did he come to the world to be lauded? To be patted on the back, to take up the crown, to be served to? No. The Son of God came to be a servant first. And he told us to pick up our cross and to follow him. that means that everything that he did, he expects us to do. We are expected to be servants. When we accept Jesus into our lives, we say two words. Jesus, I make you my Savior and my Lord. What is a Lord? America, we don't really know. We don't have such things. But crazy people like me that like to study history look back in the Middle Ages and look what it meant for someone to become somebody's Lord. When you pledged fealty to somebody who was in a position of influence over you, they had the money, they had the power, they had the means, they had the land. You would pledge fealty to them and you would make them your Lord. What that meant in the Middle Ages is you're giving up every right you had in your own life. And you are giving that to that man that was the Lord you were accepting. Now, you got some bonuses for that. They gave you land. They gave you some money. You got prestige. The higher up in the level of nobility that Lord was, the more power and prestige you got given to you. But make no mistake, they didn't go into these decisions half-heartedly, because the second that Lord calls upon your services, if you aren't there to answer his beck and call, your life is going to end horribly. They didn't play around with that. You pledged fealty to them, so the second they called you, I don't care what you were in the middle of, you got your stuff and you went to where they were calling you to go to. It's that same pledge of fealty that we're giving to Jesus when we say he is our Lord and our Savior. We're telling Jesus that we understand because of what he did for us in saving us, becoming our Savior, we are now making him Lord of our lives. So we're telling him we're giving up all claims, all rights that we have to our own personal lives, and we are now at his beck and call. We are now his servants. Whenever he needs us, for whatever he needs us for, we will answer to and do. Mary understood this concept. She understood her place at the feet of her Savior. She was submissive to Jesus because she understood he was her Lord. She didn't think of herself as better than him. She knew he was the better. And she knew that he had only her best interest at heart. As the worship team comes up here, hopefully they're still hanging around, I want you guys to do something for me. I want you to close your eyes. I'm going to read you a couple of different stories here. They're short, so don't go to sleep, please, because that would just be rude. But as I read these stories to you, I want you to try as hard as you possibly can to visualize what I'm telling you about these stories. I want you to use that mind's eye thing in the theater of your mind and try to play these stories in your head as I read them to you. During World War II, there was a young boy in a small town who was asked by his mother to go to the corner drugstore and pick something up for her. As he arrived at the drugstore, he noticed a poster on the window. This poster made a great impression upon him. So imagine, you're this young boy, you're walking down to the store, and you get to the store. It's during World War II. You know how they had all those recruiting posters all over the place? Well, this is a recruiting poster. It was on the window of the store. And it had this huge, made this huge impression on him. On this poster was a picture of an American soldier. Full battle gear, helmet, backpack, gun, all of it. Combat boots, the whole thing. Only the soldier was laying face down in the sand on the beach, an island in the South Pacific. He was dead. Waves are lapping over his body. At the bottom of that poster, underneath that picture, there was a question. It says, "What have you done for your country today that's worth this soldier having died yesterday?" Think about that. As we're thinking about Memorial Day today, or tomorrow, think like this boy thinks. What have we done for our country today to make his death yesterday worth it? Now, eyes still closed, theater still running, changing scenes. Now we're going to go outside the walls of the city of Jerusalem. Walking over to a hill called Calvary. You look up on the hill, you see three crosses standing there. You focus on the middle one. You see somebody hanging on it. His body's covered in blood. Skin hanging off in shreds. Beard ripped from his face. You can't even tell that it was a human. You look up on his head, you see a crown of thorns. You look in his one arm, left arm, it's nailed to the cross. You look at his right arm, it's nailed to the cross. You look down at his ankles, they're nailed to the cross. Just like the soldier on the beach, he's dead. Why? Why did this man die? He died for us. He died for you. He died for me. He died paying the wages of our sin because he was perfect and spotless and sinless. He didn't die for anything that he had done. So my question to you is the same as the question that was on the poster for the boy. What are you doing today with your life to make the death of Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago on that horrible cross worth it? Now, I'm not talking about earning your way into heaven. That's why Jesus came. You can't do anything to make yourself right. You can't do anything to get your way into heaven. But are you making that sacrifice that he made for you and for me, are you making it worth it by the way you're living? First of all, if you don't even know him as your Lord and Savior, then the answer to that is no. But thankfully, that can be changed. Jesus died for everybody. And he doesn't expect you to be perfect and spotless and holy before you come to him. He just wants you to come to him. He wants you to accept him as your Lord and your Savior. And he promises you that your sins will be completely forgotten, washed white. So that's the first thing you need to do if you haven't already. But if you have accepted him as your Lord and Savior, and maybe you're not living the way you know you ought to. Maybe you're not living the way Mary lived in our story. Maybe you're not living the way even you used to live at one point when you first got saved. You were hungry. You were passionate about serving Jesus any way and every way you could. But that fire may have died a little. May have gone out some. Well, guess what? It's not too late to ask forgiveness and to start living that way again. It doesn't take some special ritual to get back in the right place of God. It just takes you saying, "God, I'm sorry for what I've done. I'm sorry for what I'm not doing." Whatever the case may be for you, help me to have that fire restored inside of me again and start living your life the way you know you should. Maybe you're one of the few that is doing everything right. You're passionate. You're hungry. You're always at the feet of Jesus. You're always reading His Word. You're always praying. Thank God. Keep it up. Keep doing it. Never think that you can ever get to a place where you've done too much. Keep going. Keep running that race. Be like Paul when he was at the end of his life, when he could say proudly, I've run the race and I've completed it. We're going to close out in prayer and they're going to do one more song. And if any of you need any prayer today, I'll be happy to pray with you. We got an elder here and a deacon here. Any of us would be happy to pray with you today for any of those things that I just talked about. I know we're running late. I'm sorry, but I'm long-winded. One of my faults. Sorry. But if you need prayer, please come find one of us. Don't walk out of here missing an opportunity. Father, I thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you, Lord, that you've given us every tool that we could possibly need to live the life that you've called us to live. First and foremost, you gave us our salvation. You paid that price on that cross for us. And we don't have to go through life wondering whether or not we can be saved. Your word tells us that you've done everything. All we need to do is accept you as our Lord and our Savior. And if we do that with a sincere heart, that you will forgive us of our sins. And from that point forward, we have eternal salvation with you. Thank you for that, God. But that's just the beginning of the journey. Lord, you've called us to live a life of servanthood, a life of selflessness, a life of sacrifice for you. And you promised that none of that will be for nothing. Lord, that we are promised treasures in heaven for doing the right thing. But Lord, that should never be our motivation. Our motivation should be that we want to serve you, Lord, simply because we love you and we understand that great price that you paid for our lives. Just as the men and women that have died defending this country have paid a great, mighty price, your price was great as well. And we understand that, Lord, and we want to honor that sacrifice you made for us by living completely and totally for you. So, Lord, give us that strength. Give us that boldness. Give us that tenacity to never quit living like we know we ought to live. Lord, as we enter into this last little bit of worship time, Lord, I pray that we keep our minds and our hearts completely focused on you as we look forward to the day when we will be able to see you face to face. What an amazing day that will be. We love you, Lord, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
It will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. virgin when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? And to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Or be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Or be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. And I can only imagine. I can only imagine. And I can only imagine. Yeah, yeah. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever. Forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Well, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. And as he shines upon you, let him shine in and through and out of you, that wherever you go, people will see Jesus, the light of the world.
God bless you.